Okay. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Generation Y Conservative. I'm Chris, and today I'm joined by one of my friends who's going to be co-hosting with me. His name's Brant. We're going to be going over some of the topics from the last 2 weeks because we actually missed last week. I am still kind of getting over a cold myself right now, and we took a break for the holiday, too, for Christmas. So we have a lot to cover. I don't know if we'll get to everything. What I want everyone to do, though, is when you have an opportunity, at least stick around and tune in, because one of the things I'm going to be getting to is a letter that was written by a California liberal who has taken notice over the last year with this whole election and has gone from being a California liberal that grew up liberal in a liberal environment with their family, as well as liberal professors and people that she works with, and has now decided to be a Christian conservative because of the way that her tribe, as she puts it, has been acting with everything. So we're going to get into that. That's going to be the last thing that I go over and read that letter. Whether or not we get to all the topics in here is another thing. I might just skip over some and actually go to that, depending on how our conversation goes. But I want to thank everyone for tuning in to the podcast. Right now, if you're watching on Facebook, we have Facebook live streaming right there. So you can tune in, comment, question while we're doing things. And you also have the opportunity to tune in to this podcast later on to catch the HD video and audio version on my YouTube channel. You can actually go into YouTube and search for Generation Y Conservative, and it will come up with my channel. You can catch all the past podcasts as well as some great videos I've made on certain topics over the course of the last year. You can catch me on Twitter, which is at Gen Y Conservative without the E, so GenyConservativ, and catch me on Twitter and join in the conversation there. So those three places, Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube, where you can catch us for what we have going on. So as always, this is the podcast number 6 that we're doing. We're going over big topics that have happened over the course of the last 2 weeks. I'm going to be going into some of my favorite topics that I posted. To be very honest with you, it was really hard to narrow it down, especially with 2 weeks of material, because there was just so much that happened right before Christmas and leading up to this week, especially with Obama placing sanctions on Russia, which I believe, was it you that posted the, no, it was my buddy Bill, actually. So he posted something in regards to Obama setting these sanctions in place to make Trump look bad no matter what, because if Trump sticks with him, he's going to have a bad relationship with Putin. If he takes the sanctions away, then he's going to look like a weak leader. And Obama's kind of setting him up for this circumstance. And it's kind of messy. I think that he's putting into place counter policies to what Obama or what Trump wants to do, so that it just makes a mess when he gets in office. So anyway, that's a quick introduction into what we're doing. I want to thank Brant for coming in and co-hosting with me. So Brant, you mind me telling a little bit about your history?
No, go for it.
Okay, so Brant was in the Army, right?
Correct.
So you want to talk real quickly about your rank and what you did and everything, where you were?
Oh, Cliff Notes version. joined the Army right out of high school. Mm-hmm. Went through basic training. 9/11 happened while I was in basic training down in Fort Benning, Georgia. Reported to Fort Drum a couple weeks later, Afghanistan. Did that tour twice, two tours in Afghanistan. Came back, finished out at just under 13 years in the Army before finishing up. Yeah, so.
And I kind of knew that you would probably head in that direction because I know you as long back as your mom being our Cub Scout leader.
Yeah.
So we have that kind of going on with us. Okay, so let's get into the topics because, like I said, we have a lot to go over. Hopefully we can get to everything. But what I want to do is I want to start off with a general topic that actually covers all these things that are going on with reactions to Trump being president. Okay, so we have a 16-year-old singer, Jackie Ivanko, which you said immediately once you saw my notes here that you recognize her as singing, what was it on?
Little preteen opera singer. She was pretty fantastic, though.
I think on America's Got Talent or something like
one
that.
One of those shows. Yeah. I think she,
So she's going to be singing the national anthem at Donald Trump's inauguration on January 20th in 2017, coming up here. Well, once this news came out that she was actually going to be doing this singing for Trump's inauguration with the national anthem, all these people started commenting on Twitter and sending out tweets to basically try and dissuade her from actually participating in this. So these are some of the tweets that were put out there that I came across. Nothing says hashtag career suicide like Jackie Ivanko performing at the inauguration. Her career is failing already. She'll never live this down. And she's 16. I mean, these people, this is what, there's no shame. And I'm going to go into that a little bit later too. Here's another tweet. Nothing says losing the popular vote like having Jackie Ivanko, America's Got Talent's fifth season runner up, singing at your inauguration. And another person said he can't get any respected singing stars to agree to sing. So this was actually pretty interesting and compounded on top for liberals, in my mind, to be a problem, because it turns out that Jackie's sister is transgender. Did you know that?
I didn't, actually.
So she said, in response to all this backlash that she was getting, my family is kind of a big target. I have a transgender sister, and a lot of hate goes towards us. So now you have basically this poster family for liberals, right, to take up this issue of transgenderism and everything and talk about how, you know, the right is attacking them. And instead, the left is eating itself and going after this family because she's singing at the inauguration of Donald Trump. Right? So
got the social justice warriors.
Yeah, SJWs, man. That's exactly it. So okay, so here's something else that's interesting. Another reason why the anger being directed at Ivanko is misguided is because after coming in second on America's Got Talent in 2010, she was actually invited to sing for President Barack Obama at the National Christmas Tree Lighting, and she performed for the administration at the National Prayer Breakfast in 2012 as well. So here you have this 16-year-old girl who's now 16. She was 12 at the time, I guess, who sung at Obama's Christmas tree lighting, sung at the National Prayer Breakfast, but she's supposed to take all this heat from liberals that are protesting her right now and not do something that... How many people get to sing the national anthem at something as big as the inauguration of a president?
I mean, that's pretty outstanding. The first thing that comes to my mind is how many megastar pop stars sung at the White House during the Obama administration. And where was the backlash from the other side?
Oh, no. There's nothing. I mean, well, to be honest with you, I would put myself into the category of probably criticizing a little for showing up on Ellen and Oprah and all these talk shows all the time. And, you know, because to me, he's not the commander. He hasn't shown to be a commander-in-chief less than or more than a celebrity-in-chief to me.
Yeah,
you know, he's used this whirlwind of media attention and these people that support him and everything to use a celebrity status to do everything. I mean, and I think I go over this even a little bit later, is the fact that what liberals point out on what this guy has done good as president, it's things from The Daily Show, which is entertainment news, mm-hmm. right? It's things from Ellen pointing out things. It's things that Oprah basically, you know, pillow talk between Oprah and Michelle and and President Obama. And it's these fluff pieces, you know? But, you know, I'm not gonna criticize these big pop stars or anything that perform for any president, because... You know, if they're going to the White House, it's a big deal for them. You see groups of people. You see, you know, Boy Scout troops, Girl Scout troops, all these different people, choirs from different churches and schools and everything go in. And that's huge recognition, you know. I would not, you know, criticize anybody for taking an opportunity, for going after an opportunity to sing at something as big as the inauguration.
Well, what is it they say in media in general? Any publicity is good. I don't think this is career suicide at all. I think, if anything, even with all the negative attention she's garnering, it's just going to put her name back in the spotlight, and they're going to help her do it.
So, you know what it actually reminds me of? Did you know that, I believe he actually went through with it, Elton John sang at Rush Limbaugh's wedding because his wife wanted him to?
Oh, yeah?
And he said, listen, politics, politics aside, I disagree with him on politics and everything, but he was getting paid a great amount, I'm sure. They specifically invited him not to criticize him and his stance or being a homosexual or anything. It was because his music is fantastic. You know, I think of my childhood. I grew up in the car with my mom driving around with Elton John and Billy Joel playing. You know what I mean? It's ridiculous. So we're going to stick on that topic, actually, with things that are going on with people criticizing Trump and his supporters and everything. So up in Maine, over the last couple of weeks, there was a gas distributor who posted that he refuses to deliver gas fuel to Trump supporters. So Michael Turner, owner of Turner LP Gas in Skowhegan, Maine, recorded a voicemail greeting that leaves little to question as to his feelings for those in his community that supported Trump. So this is what his message said. Thank you for calling Turner LP Gas. If you voted for Donald Trump for president, I will no longer be delivering your gas. Please find someone else. So now here's the problem with that, though. The average temperatures in that region during the winter months fall below freezing. And the average high in December is 31 degrees, 26 degrees in January, and 30 degrees in February. So now what this really reminds me of, is to compare and contrast here, is you have all these businesses that are being criticized over the last decade or so, mainly Christian businesses and everything, for turning away people for their weddings and everything based on religious values and what they consider participation in, right? And my argument for them on that side has always been, well, listen, you have these businesses that are, they're readily available, right? Mm-hmm. You're going to, in this area alone, we live out in the middle of nowhere here in Pennsylvania. For those that are tuning in that may not know where I am, and I'm not going to tell you where I am because in case you're a crazy liberal, but but we live out in the middle of nowhere. And I swear, I personally have friends that are, there must be 5 wedding photographers, right?
Right.
So you have all these different businesses that you can go to if one turns away. And in the past, you've seen these cases where if these couples were turned away, it was done as gracefully as possible. Listen, I really apologize. I just can't do this. You know, it wasn't like giving a lecture there and then like turn, repent, or anything like that, you know? But the fact is, in those situations, literally no one is being hurt. Like the most that's getting hurt is maybe your feelings, right? But in this case, we're talking about really cold temperatures where elderly people that possibly voted for Trump are being turned down for heating fuel service.
Right.
So this has actually turned into more of a life and death situation than in comparison, right?
I agreed.
Probably other services out there.
Sure.
You know, to be fair.
Now, I followed up on this story a little bit.
And yeah, I have a little bit more here, too.
We'll let you get to it.
You know the outcome?
I do.
Okay. So, it was within a week later. What happened was, when he put himself onto the radar with this note, it was revealed that Michael Turner, who said he would not fuel anymore to those who voted for Trump, has not been licensed. Is this what you found out?
Yes.
Since 2012. So he has been delivering and dispensing gas without a state license for at least 2 years, state officials said. So this guy, to make a political point and kind of, you know, damn his clients and customers that voted for Trump, actually put him on himself on the radar to, show up on. That's some serious stuff
that's
right there.
His livelihood is now gone.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's at serious risk. If best case scenario, I'm guessing fines are involved.
I'm
heavy
sure.
Fines. Worst case scenario, he loses his business, I would think.
Not to mention, I don't remember the exact numbers, but I think they figured out what percentage of the voting population in his county was Republican. It ended up being more than half. which means, essentially, all he's doing is, chopping off his head to spite his face.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Okay, so this was another, this is kind of a quick thing. So apparently artists, like painting artists, are demanding that Ivanka Trump remove paintings from her interior of her house or apartment complex, whatever it is in New York City, I believe it was, that are theirs, that they painted themselves, because they have shown up in multiple social media pictures and videos that she posts online. So I actually saw these pictures, and there's nothing that says this work was done by Ben. Right. You know what I mean? It's nothing glaringly obvious on who did it or anything. But this is like this child elementary mentality of like, how dare you, who has an opposite opinion than me, put up something of mine in your background that you probably paid thousands, if not millions, for to, you know, I mean, it's interior design.
Yeah.
These people are flipping out over no reason at all.
I think regardless, too, I mean, it's just an example of knee-jerk responding to based on emotion rather than really thinking things through before you say them. I mean, that's like a liberal toy owner company telling everybody who bought the liberal toy, you got to send it back because yeah. I don't want you having it in your house.
We're not going to give you your money back.
Well, exactly right. And it's just so absurd to even entertain.
Here, from the opposite side of this discussion, though, I would actually point out that I do graphic design work on the side and, you know, little artsy things to keep up on my Photoshop skills and everything. And if I happen to be watching a video, you know, and the Obamas were at home and I saw one of my things up in the background, I would start laughing. I would think that that's hilarious. I would actually point it out. I would post it. I would say, they put a conservative's artwork in the background. Look at it. And like label it, like hashtag the heck out of it, you know? I would actually think it's funny, but these people just, it's meltdown mode. It's like hitting a nuclear button. So, you have more you want to say about that?
Unless you're going to cover it later, just playing the other side a little bit, there was actually someone who took that avenue that you would have. With the jewelry, and I'm not sure if you're familiar with that story. Apparently, the article was Ivanka Trump accidentally donated money to the Hillary campaign, which was in fact a little bit true. It was funny though.
Father did on purpose, by the way, in the past.
So. Right, but it was actually kind of hilarious because basically she went and bought this jewelry from this liberal company. The designers then. And this was very expensive jewelry, I can only imagine, because otherwise why would it be news? So what they did was they took the money, donated it to the Hillary campaign, and then sent a letter to Ivanka and Donald Trump to let her know that they had donated her proceeds to the campaign. So there's at least an example of somebody handling the situation a little more in jest.
If that's a prerogative, they have every right to do that, and...
At least that one made me laugh. The other one,
that's kind of funny.
Made me cry on the inside a little.
Yeah, exactly. So, those of you tuning in, I see that we have a couple more people and everything. We can see comments and questions. So, as we're going through, if you want to leave any comments or questions or say hi to Brand, I know he shared this video on his page. So, if you're one of his friends, you can give him a little shout out. He can, without cutting me off, give you a shout out back. But we're sticking with some topics that we've been covering that I've covered over the past 2 weeks. In the news, we're going over some of the political topics. So we're going to stick with Ivanka, actually. And this involves a recent incident that actually became pretty decently sized news with a passenger being kicked off of JetBlue for accosting Ivanka Trump. So Ivanka was on a JetBlue flight leaving from JFK on Thursday morning. This was before Christmas. With her family. And a passenger started screaming, "Your father is ruining the country." The guy went on and said, "Why is she on our flight? She should be flying private." The guy had his own kid in his arms and was going on this tirade. So Twitchy actually caught, because he was actually deleting his tweets as things were following up with this, that the husband of this guy that was really going at it with Ivanka, or at Ivanka, before the incident, he was actually tweeting on Twitter that Ivanka, this is his tweet, "Ivanka and Jared on our flight. My husband expressed displeasure in a calm tone. JetBlue staff overheard and they kicked us off the plane." That's actually not the tweet I thought I was going to read. But what happened was, there's actually another tweet, and I didn't put it in here, but he actually tweeted about an hour before this that they saw Ivanka waiting to get on the flight with them. And they were tweeting, "We're going to say something. We're going to do something to her." So it was all premeditated. This wasn't a confrontation where they just flew off the handle all of a sudden and went after her. But what has me a little bit concerned is actually that since this incident has happened, there's been a follow-up story, and I've covered it multiple times over the past couple weeks. Thousands of people, tens of thousands of people now, have signed a petition that is demanding that Hunter College fires the professor whose husband harassed Ivanka Trump on the flight with her children. So, you know, I think it was either the last podcast or the one before that, I was talking about this liberal who was down in, is it Gainesburg?
I think so.
In Tennessee, where the big wildfire was. And he said just this the most disgusting tweet or Facebook post about how these people deserved it down there. And they're a bunch of hillbilly cousin humping Trump supporters and everything. And what ended up happening was the conservatives that saw this went on this witch hunt and had, you know, sent all this information to his employer and had the guy eventually fired. You know, so here we are with this guy who wasn't even, yes, he was there. He was part of the situation, but he wasn't the one that was going specifically after Ivanka. And we have a petition now where people are going after Hunter College to fire this husband who wasn't even the one doing this stuff. And this is, I complain about this over the past decade or so of liberals going after, you know, conservative people and getting them fired for their political beliefs and everything. You know, why would we talk on one side of the equation and then turn around and say it's okay for our side to do this to the other side when it's done to us? I personally think that this is, you know, two sides of the same coin. I don't think it's very fair, and I don't agree with these people that are trying to petition for this.
Hey, right. And at the end of the day, you know, the public can express their, you know, displeasure, whatever you want, on social media. But at the end of the day, it's the school that has to decide if, and it's only for them to decide, is if the actions and the parties involved tarnish their reputation in any way. And if then that's the case, they would take action. For all we know, it's the world's most liberal college. They hate Trump too. And, you know, and so they don't feel slighted. So why should he be fired? I mean, at the end of the day, just, you don't like the
Did
school.
Did you look that up? Is that true?
I don't know.
Oh, okay. But, if they are.
Right, yeah, if they are. At the end of the day, you know, petition's way overboard. You don't like it, don't go to the college.
Right.
Don't send your kids there. I mean, it's that simple.
Yeah, exactly. Speak with your wallet.
Exactly right.
Yeah. Okay, so here's another thing. This is all leading down this path of just the reaction from the left lately in response to the Trumps getting ready to take office, what the rhetoric has been in the past as far as what they say they're tolerant of, and just the cards being completely on the table now with everything. And, you know, I'm spotlighting these issues because, you know, really in my heart, honestly, I want to spotlight these things because I have some personal friends of mine. One who actually follows this page, and I pray that he gets this message into his heart, because he's a liberal that just since this election has posted the most vile, hateful things, and is in the same day posting all this love everybody, you know, meditation, and like it just gets to the point where it's like, okay, you're missing things. There's a missing connection here, because if you have this much hate in your heart over here, and then you're telling us that the Republicans hate people, but you don't because you start posting loving things on Facebook. Like, point is, I'm more interested in bringing these things and spotlighting them, because you can't confront a problem with yourself even unless you're known. It's known to you, right? So in another incident, a liberal refused to stop and help a woman that was stranded in the snow. And the picture actually shows her car off into a ditch and everything. Pulled up, started to go for her, was about to get out and help her until he noticed that she had a Trump sticker on her car and just kept on going. And posted about it on Facebook saying, ha, this is so funny, I'm not going to help her. Help your, you know, contact your president to help you or something like that. And it's just like, is that what we're going to become as a society, that if we have any type of disagreement that's known with a bumper sticker or a t-shirt or anything, that you're going to have hate in your heart towards people and refuse to give a hand to help that situation, that person, you know?
I wonder what the, you know, I love that people post everything on social media nowadays. I mean, if that poor woman had passed away or developed hypothermia, I wonder what the penalty, if any, would have been for...
Well, let's go into the next topic here, which is talking about a trending topic that happened on, I believe it was Monday or Tuesday. I'm not sure, but one of the trending topics on Twitter this week was hashtag RIP Tomi Lahren. So Tomi Lahren being one of the big controversial hosts on the Blaze Network, she's the, you know, 24-year-old, I think, 24 or 25-year-old, blonde, very gorgeous girl who is just a firestorm and has been viral all over the place and has been really this conservative firestorm for people that, you know, the way I compare it, to be honest with you, is liberals have their Daily Show. They have their Jon Stewart and their Trevor Noah, who just spits what they want said out there, and they go nuts over it and post it and everything. Well, Tomi Lahren has been one of those people to fill that void on social media as a young conservative voice that you know, these people can use as an example on social media, just like the left uses with Jon Stewart and Trevor Noah. And in response to this RIP Tomi Lahren, these are the types of tweets that went out. So at the Forceful said, y'all should have known that rest in peace Tomi Lahren was fake. 2016 only took people that were talented and loved. At Fetus Larry 16 said, me, y'all wrong for wishing death on her. Also me remembering her being a racist, problematic hoe. RIP Tomi Lahren. Hunter Chan, why is RIP Tomi Lahren trending? I was so happy. I really thought 2016 got the right person for once. Also, we're going to go on from that because there's actually some more Twitter stories that follow up with this type of hatred and everything. But this is what Tomi Lahren actually came back from her winter holiday break to address this concern on her social media, because it was just, it's this vile hatred, right? I mean, you don't like someone. What is this saying that we grew up with?
It sticks and stones, right?
Now that you said that, I have that in my head. If you don't have anything nice to say.
Don't say anything at all. Sure.
But now with social media, right, we have this platform that we want to get up on a soapbox and see how many people will hit that thumb up button or hit that like button or hit that share button to see how many people can just tap into this pipeline of hatred. That's what it's become. And this isn't something that's just on the left. You know, this is the same thing, and I get to this a little bit further down here. But it's the same thing I was noticing with Trump supporters, right? And I'm talking about a very specific type. But, you know, Trump was making an impact because he was saying what some people wanted to hear. Mm-hmm. There was and actually, to be honest with you, Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump had a similar strategy, believe it or not. What they found was a way to tap into the emotional pipeline of the American public on their respective sides and either echo the sentiments of those people or say exactly what those people wanted to hear.
Yeah.
Right? So these two candidates were tapping into this pipeline, and through no fault of their own, I mean, that's great marketing strategy to get in a political office, right? But these hateful political ads that you see every single year actually had less of an effect than what these two were actually saying to tap into these people's emotions. So in this case here, Tomi, she comes off angry.
Oh, sure.
You know, there's, to be very frank, I mean, on both sides, everybody has something to be angry about, right? But in this case, what both sides have to learn is that you tap into something, you don't like an opinion, you know, develop a counter opinion and start arguing your case, right? Use facts. And it's actually something, quickly, I go back in my history. When I started the Generation Y Conservative blog, what I did was I was getting down in the mud with liberals. This was back in the early 2000s. And I was mudslinging back and forth and everything. And really just, you know, those conversations devolve. Once someone mudslings and the other person does, that's all it becomes. It's not about facts anymore. So my wife said to me one time, you know, this is really getting ugly. This is not you. When you get into an argument with someone, present the facts. That's all you have to do. Don't do name calling. Don't mudsling or anything. If they do it, keep on presenting facts, because they're going to make themselves look like idiots.
Yeah.
And that's actually what I've stuck with. That's been one of my, you know, guidelines and principles and pillars.
I think you're right. I mean, watching debates, watching speeches, you know, whenever it turns into a pissing match, nobody wants to watch that anymore. It becomes unentertaining. I really enjoy watching people like who are able to maintain their composure, like Trey Gowdy, and people that are able to come back with facts while maintaining their composure and not resorting to...
Trey Gowdy's a bulldog. I hope he gets a bigger position.
He is one of my favorites. I could listen to that man talk all day.
So we actually have Gabe Badesso.
Hey, Gabe.
So Gabe said on here that he says that conservatives, he finds them to be more generous and liberals take the human cause. And he's absolutely right. So what you actually have is when you're having discussions with people, the liberal argument tends to go emotional. Okay. It's an emotional response to how people are treated or how a situation is approached. And you can present all the facts that you want. It doesn't really matter, because if those facts present a case that still taps into a negative emotion for them, then it holds no meaning. They throw it out the window. Whereas conservatives, there's an emotional response too. Don't get me wrong. I mean, where I would disagree with you, Gabe, is just like when people like Tomi, Lahren are confronted on issues like this, you have just as much of a firestorm of people retaliating. And I'm trying to take this disconnected approach of saying, listen, you know, we need to approach this in a more loving manner. I mean, here I am sounding like the liberal. You know what I mean?
Well, you know, I think it comes down to there's the person and there's the politics.
Right.
And where the disagreement lies typically is with the politics. And you know, I think people need to learn. You need to be able to disagree with someone's point of view. You know, I like red, you like blue, you know, so you're a scumbag, I hate you. That just doesn't make sense, you know, and, you know, in the political arena, I understand that people get very passionate. It really taps into a personal set of feelings. But, you know, it's important to be able to debate or argue or call it whatever you want to do, but let it end with the politics and don't let that those feelings move past that.
Yeah. Don't let it tap into the friendship.
Because, I mean, I don't think anybody would say that their political, you know, affiliations or their political opinions defines who they are. You know? Well, I mean, more important to some than to others, for sure.
Yeah.
But, you know, the bottom line is it's not that all that's there to define a person, and the sling hate, you know, based on political views is really just...
it's to hurt people.
Well, it's counterproductive, really.
It is. It is. Absolutely is. It stops conversation.
Yeah, immediately.
Okay, so to go off of that a little bit more, you know, dealing with Twitter and this hatred, Charlie Sheen apparently tweeted that he was hoping that 2016 would claim Donald Trump's life as well. So I said in one of my posts, isn't it fascinating that some of the banners that the left waves for tolerance, anti-bullying, and anti-hateful Trump-like rhetoric all seem to fly out the window when they want to say what they want to? You know, I mean, all this time we're talking about not bullying and this hateful rhetoric that the right produces with people like Donald Trump and everything. But when it comes time for them to criticize the right or people like Donald Trump, it's like, well, who cares? I don't have to live up to my own standards, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I think that when they're holding those banners up, I truly do believe that they do believe that.
Yeah, absolutely.
I don't think that they aspire to bully. I think they lose sight of it when somebody attacks them passionate, you know, something that they're passionate about and their feelings. Yeah. They lose sight of it for a moment.
So what I want to do again is, if you're tuning in right now, like one of our friends did earlier here, he posted a comment, and we're also taking questions as we go through the podcast. What I would also encourage you to do, and it would be a really big help to spread the awareness of this podcast, is to actually hit the share button and share it on your private page as well. And then later on, if and they do like the page as well, they can actually find the HD version, which includes the whole set, not just these blackboards behind me here on the Facebook live feed. And you can actually catch the HD audio and video version of that as well then. So moving on from what we were talking about with the Twitter hatred going towards Tomi Lahren and Donald Trump, you know, what I said in regards to those things is that the hypocrisy of the left and their hateful hearts and nastiness are spotlighted with these types of things. So one of the messages, I was thinking about rewriting this message for this podcast, but I don't think I could put it any better than I already did, which is, I said, I have seen the twisted side of humanity over the last decade, but nothing compares to 2016's behavior of people. I posted earlier this year that I was concerned that Trump supporters had taken up the tone of Trump and his boastfulness and harsh comments, but that has seemingly died off since his win. What we are left with, however, is a large portion of the liberal left in this country doing exactly what they have been preaching against for years: bullying, hatefulness, nasty attitudes, and hypocrisy. I have a few very loving liberal friends that have posted nothing but hateful, venomous, and downright nasty posts about Donald Trump and his supporters, some of whom happen to be their friends. I see them demanding the Electoral College vote be overturned with the election and to stop Trump, and that Obama follow through and push sanctions against Russia for tampering with the election, and then following it up with posts about how Fox and conservative commentators have been relentless in their attacks on President Obama for the last 8 years. It's almost like they forget that back in October, they jumped behind Hillary Clinton in demanding Donald J. Trump accept the results of the election no matter the outcome. They seem to forget that Barack Obama has stated for years that there has never been any sign of election fraud, and nor are there signs there could be. They seem to be blissfully ignorant to the 8 years of George W. Bush and how the mainstream media, liberal commentators, their liberal friends, college professors, and they themselves have absolutely had meltdowns over every single thing he did and tore him apart and called him a buffoon and bumbling idiot. You had writers and directors portraying the assassination of the president in books and movies, but they're upset that we're criticizing Obama's policies? The left is suffering from what I like to call sore loser syndrome right now, the symptom of years of participation trophies. They expected some sort of consolidation prize after winning this election, but instead, their hypocrisy, hatred, bullying, and contempt for anyone who doesn't hold the same opinion as them is on full display and spotlighted. So America's starting to wake up to the fact that the tolerant left is anything but.
Well said. You know, the thing on Russia gets me. Oh, yeah. I gotta tell you. I mean, I can't remember what it was. I'm sure you do. What did Obama say to Mitt Romney about Russian interference?
Oh, it's not the 1980s anymore. Oh, right. So put your Cold War policies away.
Right. So Russian interference is okay as long as it leans liberal.
Yeah.
Got it.
So here was an interesting article that came out as well. It was an article in regards to political relationships online, with Facebook and Twitter and everything. So this study that was done found that Democratic women are most likely to delete or unfriend someone on social media due to politics, according to a recent Public Religion Research Institute survey. So PRRI, a nonpartisan research organization, conducted the survey among a little over 1,000 adults between December 7th and the 11th. What they found was that 24% of Democrats said that they have unfriended people or stopped following or even blocked someone on social media after the election due to political posts. In comparison, only 9% of Republicans and 9% of independents said the same. So a survey also found a substantial gender gap among those who unfriended others in social media and over political differences. Women are twice as likely to admit that they have deleted someone from social media because of politics. And in fact, 18% of women admitted to removing someone from social media compared to 9% of men. 30% of Democratic women said they have removed someone from social media over a political opinion, while 14% of Democratic men said the same. However, on the other side of the equation, you had 10% of Republican women admitting to deleting, and compared to 8% of Republican men. So, quickly go over that again. 30% of Democratic women, as opposed to 10% of, so a third, of Republican women, and then 14% of Democratic men, as opposed to 8% of Republican men.
The idea of deleting somebody, you know, aside from the obvious, you know, I get overly passionate, and I've known to lose my cool a little bit. But when you're deleting people that don't think like you, what you're doing is eliminating dialogue.
Yeah.
Or even the possibility of dialogue,
You're eliminating ideas to enter into your scope and sphere.
You're eliminating the possibility, somebody that is that passionate about their position, whether it be liberal or Republican, has to have a desire, an innate desire to sway the opinion of others, however they do that, to their side. Well, how are you going to do that if you're not talking to them, if you're not trying to start a dialogue? I mean, I may post something about something, it doesn't really matter. Any post, to my page that is, leans very, very conservative. And I won't lie, I'll check back on it a few times in hopes that one of my liberal friends, had something to say about it. Because, especially if they're friends, you should be able to have those conversations. And I think they're important, there's been more than once where, I kind of got left sitting there going, well, now do I? Well, I'm wrong. Shoot. Well, if I delete this, then it shows. But if I don't delete it, then I just look dumb. The bottom line is discussion is important. It's always going to be important. Nothing changes without it.
I have some advice on that actually, which is there's different things that you can do in regards to social media on how you interact with people, right? So there's the ability to completely block someone so that they can't even find you on social media. You can unfriend them, and eventually they're probably going to find out with that because you'll probably show up in their suggested friends. And then you also have the ability to hide them from your newsfeed, right? So that what they're saying just doesn't show up. You're still friends with them. You just don't see what they're posting unless you personally go to their page and start looking through to find something and dig for that dirt, right? So, I actually, funny enough, just because I was really interested how this election would turn out, especially because I just didn't like either of the candidates too much, I just really wanted to find out what this election would cost me in friendships, which I really don't care. Like, listen, I know who my good friends are. Right. You know what I mean? So if I get defriended by someone that I haven't seen since high school, I don't really care too much. But I wanted to see. So I downloaded an app that actually showed me the friends I was losing over the course of this election. And I was laughing so hard because I could see why I was losing them. I knew that they were liberal people, liberal friends and everything. And these are people that never once got involved in any of the discussions. They didn't even try to persuade me to see things differently. They didn't try to argue their points or anything. They're just like, nope. I mean, these are people that, we're talking about the tolerant left here,
I think more than tolerant, we're talking about a group of people that the majority of which preach diversity as being a foundation of their platform. And the minute there is a little diversity, somebody who doesn't share the same type of thought, diversity is no longer good. So I suppose that's liberal diversity. What did Gabe have to say here?
Yeah, he was chiming in about the social media. I couldn't quite understand the question, but he's talking about how go ahead.
I'd rather know what the other side thinks. And social media gives you a window into that world, even if I disagree. Yeah, exactly right.
Okay, yeah, now I understand. Yeah.
Exactly right.
Well, listen, I've said it before, too. I was on the school board around here, and I, in conversations, praised the liberals that were on the board with me in public when I talked to other people. Because I said, listen, they came at situations from a different angle. I really appreciated their input. Sometimes it had an effect on how I approached a situation. It didn't always change my mind. But there was an open discussion that allowed you to view the full scope of things and take things in from a different point of view. At the same time, those liberals that were on the board with me were working with the teachers union, certain people as a teachers union representatives. They were working with the Women's League of Voters. They were working with people in the community, all to get me off the board because I was a conservative. Not a reaction to any of the choices or things I voted on, but purely because I had a conservative blog, of which I never mentioned anything about being on the school board or mentioned school board issues or policies.
Right.
So It's almost like a one-sided street where the other side of the street is kind of saying we go down this street, but they don't.
Yep. I mean, I think you might have been following me shortly before I got here on a little debate I was having with someone I've never met. But, you know, the bottom line is he did end up making a comment because he was able to, for the most part, maintain his composure and presenting, well, I'll assume they're facts until I've checked them. I can't say that they're not. But because he was able to maintain that, now, do I think he'll dissuade my my views on the issue, even if he's right? Probably not. All right. But the bottom line is there was a statement made that I'm going to go home and check it. It's the first thing I'm going to do when I get home tonight. And if he is right, it's going to give me something to think about. Mm-hmm. That, you know, so that dialogue is really important.
I didn't see that comment, so I'll have to check it.
Yeah, you'll have to check out the end of it there. Yeah.
Okay, so maybe a couple of weeks ago, you may have heard about this situation where it was almost a mirror situation to one of the earlier incidents of these faux Trump supporter attacks on people. And what actually ended up happening was the first one was this: apparently, two Trump supporters, male, white males, attacked a Muslim female on a college campus. They took her hijab, or tried to take her hijab, and was yelling obscenities at her about her having to leave the country now because Donald Trump was the winner. And it turned out that this was fake, a fake story, and she actually got questioned on it, and it came out that this was fake. And then a mirror incident, except for the location, this Muslim 18-year-old, or no, her sister's 18, but she's in this age range, was on a train, and two male white Trump supporters tried to take her hijab, started yelling obscenities at her, and there's no witnesses for it, right?
And in today's age, nothing on social media or on a cell phone, of course.
Yeah, exactly. So this took the world by storm, and once again, all these people started posting these fake stories and not following up with it on the truth of the matter. And what happened was the sister of this Muslim woman came behind the Trump attack, came out and lashed out against the NYPD once the truth came out. So her sister, Yasmin Saweed, who's 18, finally admitted to cops on Wednesday. Oh, okay, so it was that girl that was 18. Finally admitted to cops on Wednesday, last Wednesday, that her story about the verbal abuse from three white men yelling Donald Trump was all a lie because she didn't want to get in trouble with her dad for breaking curfew. So she was arrested and charged with obstructing governmental administration and filing a false report. And that was pretty interesting to know exactly what she was arrested for, because when I brought this conversation up with my father, he said, well, why the heck would she get arrested for just telling a lie? But when you actually file a police report and they have to spend their time and resources on doing that kind of stuff, that's a pretty big deal when you actually think about it. Like, that's
going back to the young man who flew away in the balloon, and they do you remember that story?
No.
Completely non politically related, but it was a similar issue that went viral, where a young man hopped into a balloon, it took off, and
oh yes, that was years ago.
Yeah, they ended up telling him they knew it wasn't true all along; it was for publicity.
But they're all looking for him and everything,
right,
at the time.
And yes, so for time exactly. spent, they got the same.
So anyway, things snowballed. Okay, so this is what her sister said on social media. Just part of it. She actually released this pretty big statement. But things snowballed out of control because of the media. Reporters made things so much worse for our family, she wrote. I had more than one cop tell me that they've looked through all our social media, and it doesn't look good that we've been vocal about certain issues they perceive to be anti-Trump, anti-white, and even anti-men. The NYPD should have never been involved in the first place, even if the incident did happen. It became super clear to me that these past 2 weeks that the police's first instinct is to doubt your story and try to disprove it. Completely ignoring the fact, of course, that her sister actually filed a claim with the police or a police report on the incident. So she's blaming the NYPD for getting involved, even though her sister is the one that filed the police report.
Naturally.
Pretty.
But now she was how old again?
The woman that was supposedly attacked was 18.
Okay. Well, then, yeah. Should be old enough to know better.
Yeah. Let me see here. I'm going to be actually skipping over this next story. There's actually some funny stories in here, too. So, This one, if you want to go on my page, you can actually read up on this story, but a student pro-life sign allegedly was taken down since it hinders what folks are feeling comfortable with. And it's an interesting story. I think it's stupid because it's just, you know, all these different clubs, including LGBT, pro-LGBT clubs and all these other things in the school are allowed to have up their posters and everything. But here you have a poster that said that had all these things and then all these hearts that represented 100... Let me just read it real quick. It featured 300 hand-painted hearts, each representing 10 lives, and was titled 3,000 Lives Are Ended Each Day. And they included the words abortion crossed out with some of the letters to spell adoption instead. So you're presenting, here we are, we're talking about the left being labeled, self-labeled as pro-choice, right? Okay. And here you have a choice being presented on this poster of adoption as opposed to abortion, and there's a hissy fit that's thrown. Someone feels uncomfortable, so it immediately has to be taken down. And, you know, you can look in through all my past and all these podcasts I've done on abortion and how I feel that there's just basically no reason to have an abortion. Well, there just isn't.
For groups that are constantly harping on equality, you know, they have to learn to define equality and then stick to it. Equality would be, in this case, allowing the other side to put a pro-choice, tasteful pro-choice poster next to the anti-abortion poster. That would be, now,
freedom of speech.
Right, but not forcing the other side to take theirs down.
Right. Can I actually go over something with you?
Please.
And we'll end the conversation if you want to. But would you mind telling your personal story about when you were small?
Oh, gosh.
Just like a quick, brief overview of it?
Brief overview.
Say yes or no, and then I'm
going to
say
yeah, something. It's fine, sure.
Okay, so I'm going to allow him to do that, but what I want to say real quick in response to all this is one of the things I went over in the past is that my family exists. 25 members of my family exist because my grandfather was a product of a rape, and instead of getting an abortion at the time, the family decided to give that baby to the mother's sister and have him raised under her as the mother. And because of that, we all exist today. It's this chain, you know, reaction of a family tree and everything. And it's a beautiful thing. So there's great things can come from ugly circumstances. And if you're willing to tell yours, you have an amazing, amazing circumstance of just ugliness that has turned into great things.
Well, Cliff's notes. We're running out of time. I'm the product of two parents that made incredibly bad decisions involving drugs and breaking the law. I was a product of the foster care system for a number of years before finally settling into a open adoption with the Beitlers, who are wonderful and have done a wonderful job raising me. But with that came along, you know, a lot of baggage. you know, at that age, you're just not able to understand, you know.
Can you talk about how you were found? Because you told me that story at one point. You don't want to.
Because
how old were you?
Well, the majority of the bad stuff going on happened between 1 and 4. And when they did find me, I was in my father's apartment in Bethlehem. He had not been there for over a week. so one of the neighbors called CPS and, I was, I don't know. I've read the report. I don't remember. It's too long
ago. But you, as someone that was under 4 years old, you were taking care of your brother who was how old at the time?
No. It wasn't. No. The only brother that I have, is a half brother. I've never
met. Okay. So even still, I mean, you're,
it was just me. So I was in poor medical condition.
Yeah, absolutely. So in this case, though, what we have is you. Now, this wasn't an abortion versus adoption. The circumstances had already happened. But you, what I'm trying to point out here is the fact that there's an opportunity through the adoption system where the most horrible of circumstances can happen and you can come out okay.
Well, sure you can. I mean, in my case, it was mostly my defiance. Yeah. Statistically, they try to tell you that, you know, if you're in the adoption system, at least this was the case back then. I know things have gotten much better. That you're going to end up in jail. Mm-hmm. You know, well, my defiance made me want to tell anybody who was older than me.
But no. You were given a chance.
No, absolutely right.
You had a choice between two lives to live, at least two lives to live.
As a matter of fact, I was given more choice. You know, I wasn't just given to a family. I was asked if I wanted to be a part of that family. I was asked if I wanted to keep my biological father's last name. There's a lot of stigma around adoption, and people, you know, they watch the movies, they watch Oliver Twist, and it really isn't that way. It really isn't. It's a much better system, especially nowadays.
Mm-hmm. There's still flaws, though.
Oh, yeah, there'll always be flaws.
I mean,
it's a messy business.
Well, you know, the one...
not as messy as the alternative.
The biggest argument I hear is, you know, you talk about how... this is the argument that's thrown at me. You talk about how adoption is this, you know, means of which you can throw kids into, but look how many kids are waiting for adoption. Well, I would actually point to that if we're going to fix this abortion issue, we also need to fix the adoption system too, because I have at least two couples that are friends of ours that have waited for well over 7 years for a child to come through a system that they can adopt. So, and they're great people that have already adopted, right? And you actually know them. I won't say who right now, but the fact is that, you know, there's this brokenness in the system that there's so much red tape and everything else involved. Of course, we don't want kids going into really bad homes and being abused and everything, but there's also so much red tape that these kids are growing up in all this meantime and not being able to go to these families either.
No, that's correct.
You know? So I want to go, I'll hit a funny story after that, kind of depressing, sorry.
That's about all right.
So a family's funny Christmas card caused a global controversy right before the holiday. The card shows James Johnson holding a sign that reads, "Peace on Earth," and next to his son, who's flashing a thumbs up, while Mrs. Johnson and her daughter sit bound with Christmas lights around their wrists and packing tape over their mouths.
I didn't see that.
You didn't see it? It's actually, and it was a really well done Christmas picture too. But people started flipping out over this, right? So all these Facebook viewers started to complain that the card was sexist, misogynist, and supported a culture of domestic abuse. This guy, Isaac Maxfield, sarcastically wrote, "It's just not the same without a couple of black eyes. Maybe next year you can get a makeup artist to help you really portray the beauty of domestic abuse." So my question, though, after I posted it and was laughing about it, I actually started to get this response from conservative women I know who said, well, I see, like, they were going off on it, too. I'm thinking to myself, my word, are we not allowed to have a sense of freaking humor anymore? And to go with that, too, I opened up. As soon as I saw this, I'm like, okay, am I really missing something here? The fact is, no, I am not missing something. And I'll point out why. Had this been reversed, had it been the mother holding that sign and all the little girls holding up their thumbs and the father was gagged.
Oh, then it's funny.
Then it's hilarious. Yeah. Because, oh, the dominant males in the household are finally the ones that are being gagged up. I mean, this is such hypocrisy. It comes down. This is the number one thing that drives me nuts with the liberal left is this hypocrisy. They can never switch the table, go put the foot on the other shoe, and see that if you reverse a situation, that if their argument just falls apart.
We grew up, you know, in a different time with things like Adam Sandler and the Jerky Boys. You know, we learned how to laugh at mildly inappropriate...
Highly inappropriate things.
Okay, highly inappropriate things. A great example of that would be the post that your wife asked you to put on your Facebook page.
Yeah, what was that?
That was a female construction worker.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Mm-hmm. There was a meme out there that said, it was a woman holding a blueprint and a construction hat, and it said,
I wonder what kind of sandwich she's making.
Yeah.
Or building.
What kind of sandwich she's building.
Which is inappropriate.
And my wife thought it was hilarious.
And none of us are implying that a woman can't be a construction worker, but...
Yeah, but they make sandwiches better.
But it's fun. you're on your own.
So, I briefly want to talk about this, you know, because there was this kind of outcry over this last week between two different sides of this story. There were the people that were really upset over Carrie Fisher, who played Princess Leia in the Star Wars movies. She died from a massive heart attack last Friday, and she survived until Monday, I believe. And then there's people like some of my conservative Christian friends who have posted things. I'm not going to name names or anything, but it kind of got me a little upset because they said something like, you know, these people aren't, you know, we hold up these people and really what we should be concerned about is if they didn't find Christ in their lives, they're going to be in hell, and that's what you should be concerned about. That was a post that was actually put out there. And while I understand their point of view on that, here's what I would say. You know, I get upset when people, get all worked up over the deaths of celebrities or celebrities winning these big awards and everything, like they're more important than people. But for our generation, Star Wars defined portions of our generation.
Sure.
You know? And, with that, I would throw in there Jurassic Park and movies like that, TV shows like The Simpsons and everything. And, Star Wars was this space soap opera, right?
Sure.
That it allowed kids back in the 80s to escape the reality into this whole different universe where...
It was the Harry Potter of our time.
It was the Harry Potter of our time. Exactly. That's a great way of putting it. But so, Carrie Fisher, I was pretty upset because, Star Wars is seeing this resurgence with the new episodes being released and the side stories, which have been just fantastic. I love them all. I'll never get enough. My daughters are even addicted to the animated Star Wars shows and everything. But so let's go a little bit political and see where politics fits into this with Carrie Fisher. So what we had was Steve Martin, the comedian, mm-hmm. another guy that we grew up with, an icon of comedy, marked the death of Carrie Fisher with what a lot of people would consider a beautiful tweet that triggered feminists to melt down over it. And what he said was, "When I was a young man, Carrie Fisher was the most beautiful creature I had ever seen. She turned out to be witty and bright as well." So New York Magazine tweeted, "Remember Carrie Fisher for her talent, her feminism, her commentary on mental health, not for the way she looked." Now, correct me if I'm wrong here, but are we not told by the left almost all the time that, people don't get complimented anymore? People aren't like, you're not nice to people. Here's Steve Martin. He didn't say like, "Oh, that hoe, I want to slap that behind," or anything like that. He's talking about she was a beautiful woman who was also witty and bright. And she, in a lot of right, she actually was a screenwriter and director and everything. She did a lot of really great things. But we had this feminist meltdown about you can't compliment people anymore.
No, you definitely can't. And it was a beautiful tweet. It's not like they took Cinnabon's tweet. Right.
Oh, I heard about that. I didn't see it though.
Oh, it was it was actually very well done. It was artistic. They took powdered sugar and cinnamon and drew out her face. It was real well done.
They put
the Cinnabon as the the quote was rest in peace, Carrie. You'll always have the best buns in the galaxy. Right. But I didn't see any literal explosion about that. But this is somebody, I don't know if they ever worked together. I'm sure that their paths crossed, and I'm sure they had mutual mm-hmm. respect as two successful people working in the same industry.
Yeah.
A successful man, a successful woman, both with long, successful careers in the acting industry. I mean, that right there, is a testament to, the fact that you can make it as a man or a woman in that industry. But... going back to that being a childhood thing, I think at some point everybody had a crush on Princess Leia,
Absolutely.
That there's just a lot of nostalgia with that character, and yeah, it was.
And not only was she the sexy princess that wore the metal bikini as the slave to Jabba the Hutt and everything, which was one part of her character, but feminists should recognize her as the bold princess that went into situations with her blaster going, leading the pack in some cases, becoming a general in the later movies and the leader of the Rebels Alliance and everything. I mean, this was a feminist dream of a character, right? A bold character that men also found powerful and sexy too, all at the same time. And there's no reason why you can't have all those attributes at the same time.
I think people, I'm not a woman, so I don't speak out on feminism a whole lot because
feminism isn't the same anymore.
No, it's not. Well, the movement is not, right?
No,
but,
it's not.
I don't see any backlash from men about the fact that, if you go back and watch the movies, you know, what the men are basically the immature little boys, and mm-hmm. she's the powerful voice of reason. You know, that.
Oh, which one to go over? We'll hit that letter last. I kind of just want to hit one of these. So do you want to talk about the Navy nixing the plans to rename all their positions that had the word man in them? Or do you want to talk
Depends
about...
how much time do we have.
Well, see, from your military background, or we could talk about our backyard and down in Philadelphia, Drexel University professor that says the only thing he wanted for Christmas was white genocide.
Oh, let's tackle the Navy, because the white genocide thing, I mean, that's a story that's replayed itself probably 50 times over the mm-hmm. last 2 weeks in different ways, shape, or forms. It's just nonsense.
Okay, so if you're not familiar with the Navy and their terms for the ranks and everything,
sure.
A lot of them, if not most of them, have the word man in them. And over the last year, there's been a big debate on the issue on whether or not to change these, because the Navy is allowing more and more females into the service, and they felt it was discriminating based on gender, right? So the Navy has come out over the last 2 weeks and said that they plan to nix those plans to rename all the positions with man in their title. After facing a backlash, the Navy decided to forgo its previous plan to remove various enlisted soldiers' job titles, namely ones that ended in man. In what was originally an effort to be more politically correct, the Navy announced their plans to eliminate their longstanding tradition of titles back in September. They decided to instead refer to the sailors by their rank only, like petty officer or chief, to ensure titles were more gender neutral. So the issue itself arose in January when the Navy decided to participate in a review of their titles, and the review coincided with the Pentagon's orders to open all combat jobs to women. So that's across the board for the military. And the goal was to eliminate titles like corpsman, corpsman, and boatswain's mate. Yeah.
that's a Navy only.
Yeah. Because the Navy felt that those titles would be too confusing for the public to understand. But after months of angry feedback, I signed a petition.
I signed it too.
The Navy officials decided the job titles would remain as is, canceling their revamping plan. So go ahead.
Well, look, we've seen this argument before. Not with the military, but, you know, I remember when there was a big hubbub, you know, over fireman and policeman, and, you know, and I'm sitting there thinking, well, then why not just say policeman and policewomen? At what point did gender and sex become an insult? I think what you're teaching people is that, you know, in some way, shape, or form, to identify with their own gender is in some way a weakness. Mm-hmm. And I think that's not the empowering message that especially the liberal left wants to send. And, you know, as far as the military goes, now granted, we don't have those titles in the Army. We just don't. The Navy, though, it's a long history of using those titles. I mean, what, you know, you would assume that anybody who joins the Navy is going to be steeped in, you know, in that history.
What they're getting into.
Well, not only that, but they're going to be steeped in that history. And, you know, you can make an argument either way, that it's sexist not to, you know, now that women are finally in, you know, and they wanted to become corpsmen, now they can't because we're going to call it something else. Yeah. And they've missed out on that, you know.
Well, to be honest with you, what it really reminds me of this is this whole millennials entering the workforce situation, right, where you have companies. So millennials are having this big problem, and you and I both posted this video, I think. That guy talking about millennials entering the workforce and everything.
Yeah, it was wonderful.
Really good. But it's something I've been saying for years with helicopter parenting and everything. But what I want to point out on that is that you have these millennials that are entering the workforce that don't believe in the corporate ladder anymore, that they believe because of their education and because of the way that they have control over technology, over some of their supervisors and everything, that they can skip over certain job titles and be managers immediately upon hiring. And this culture of this entitlement, right? And so what you're actually finding, and this is the craziest thing, is you're finding these seminars happening across the country, possibly across the world, where people are going to these seminars as company leaders to learn how to turn their company around and cater to these individuals, right? Instead of having seminars for the millennials of this generation, going into a seminar to learn how to change your worldview from what being getting all these participation trophies and everything that you were given and handed and everything in college, and learning how to adapt to the real world, and your life's about to change because you're no longer the special little snowflake that you think you are. We can find someone to replace you, right? You know, but instead we're turning the situation around to be that the companies have to be the ones to change, you know. So in this case here, we have the Navy, you know, contemplating changing job titles just because a change in gender coming into the situation. It's ridiculous. You know what the situation is. You know what you're getting into. These are long-standing things. It blows my mind.
You have to remember the head of the military is the commander-in-chief.
And who's that?
Right.
So the guy who wore mom jeans.
Right.
So it says a lot right there.
But, yeah.
All right. So we're going to get to the last one here. Again, if you're tuning in right now, you can leave comments and questions and we'll try to get to them. We'll do a brief kind of quick overview after I hit this last letter here and give you an opportunity to join in and join the discussion if you missed any of the topics and want to, you know, say anything or have a question about it. So once again, I'm joined by Brent, my friend here. And if you are watching on Facebook Live, I appreciate it. You can also tune in to watch me on the YouTube channel, which is the Generation Y Conservative on there. You can find the HD audio and video versions on there, typically 2 days after I do the taping of this live on Facebook. So I'd encourage you to like the Generation Y Conservative page, share the video, get involved in the discussion. It just opens it up and a lot more. And this is just a testament to, you know, having fun with people coming in and co-hosting with me, is it just really opens up the discussion, which is what I was really looking for. And we weren't able to cover everything today. So I'm going to be inviting some more people that I know to come in and co-host and invite people back like Brent, because he did a great job.
And if I may add, discussion, you know, doesn't always have to be one-sided, so you don't have to be conservative to like or follow the page. Again, with the dialogue, the comments need to come from both sides.
Yep. So the last thing I'm going to go over, I mentioned it at the beginning of the show, of the podcast, was this letter that a former liberal California citizen who is now turning to a Christian conservative viewpoint wrote this letter to the American Conservative website. And it blew my mind, because self-realization of what's wrong in your circumstances is the first step to correcting whatever you have going on, whether it's alcoholism or smoking cigarettes. You know what I'm saying? So this is the woman's letter. She said, "I'm a secular agnostic Californian and longtime reader of your blog. I've enjoyed your books, beginning with Crunchy Cons, and have valued your insights over the years. Though you don't know me, I feel like I know you and your family, and I want to share with you from the liberal bastion of Northern California that I am officially tired of the type of people who have surrounded me my entire life. In the wake of Trump's election, I am experiencing tribe fatigue. I'm not tired of the other detestable tribe. I'm tired of my own. A bit about me. I am a something that they deleted with two young children. My parents were non-religious Democrats, and my ex-Catholic mom loathes organized religion to this day. So I was raised a secular liberal. My college professors were secular liberals. During my journalism phase, my newspaper colleagues were secular liberals. My law school professors and peers were, in the vast majority, secular liberals. Almost everyone at my corporate law firm was a secular liberal. My California neighbors and friends are secular liberals, as are my colleagues. My mother, siblings, and their spouses are all secular liberals. By all rights, I should be a member in good standing of their tribe, liking their Facebook posts and joining their candlelight vigils against the evil Trump administration. But November 8th and its aftermath revealed to me that I am just so tired of these people. I can't be like them, and I don't want my kids turning into them. I'm tired of their undisguised contempt for tens of millions of Americans with no effort to temper their response to the election with humility or empathy. I'm tired of their unexamined snobbery and condescension. I am tired of their name-calling and virtual signaling as signs of supposedly high intelligence. I'm tired of their trendiness, jumping on every left liberal bandwagon that comes along, transgender activism, anyone, and then acting like anyone who not on board is either an idiot or a hater. I'm tired of their shallowness. It's hard to have a deep conversation with people who are obsessed with moving their kids' pawns across the board with grades, sports, college, grade school, career, and in their spare time, entertaining themselves and taking great vacations. I'm tired of their acceptance of vulgarity and sarcastic irreverence as a cultural ocean in which their kids swim. I like pop culture as much as the next person, but people who would never raise their kids on junk food seem to think nothing of letting them wallow in cultural junk, exposed to nothing ennobling, aspirational, or even earnest. I'm tired of them raising clueless kids who go off to college and within months are convinced that they live in a rapey, racist patriarchy. Make America Great Again is hate speech, and Black Lives Matter agitators are their brothers in arms against white privilege. If my kids are like that at 19, I'll feel I've seriously failed them as a parent. Yet the general sentiment seems to be these are good, liberal kids who may have gotten a bit carried away. I'm tired of their lack of interest in any form of serious morality or self-betterment. These are decent, responsible people, many compassionate by temperament, yet they seem two-dimensional, as if they believe that being a nice, well-socialized person who holds the correct political views is all there is, and there is nothing else to talk about. Isn't there, though? I'm tired of being bored and exasperated by everybody. I feel like I've read this book 1,000 times and there are no surprises in it. Down with Trump. Trans lives matter. Climate deniers are destroying the planet. No cake. We're gluten-free. These are good people in a lot of ways, but there has got to be a better tribe. That leads me to, drumroll, the Christian right. It is no small feat switching tribes. It feels stressful and weird to abandon your tribe for the detestable other side. Since November 8th, my husband and I have been taking the kids to church. He is politically conservative with a religious bent, so no argument there. I have come this close to buying a giant poster of the American flag for my living room. I may still do it. Right now, I'm struggling to accept the basic Christian doctrines, virgin birth, resurrection, second coming, because I feel the Christian tribe may be the right tribe for my family. We just finished watching a BBC miniseries about the birth of Jesus, which was so beautiful and moving compared to secular TV. My 9-year-old really enjoyed it. I want to prepare my kids to live according to some unchanging truth, not subject to every passing trend, and this felt like a start. But I worry that an inability to believe in the supernatural aspects of the faith will limit my ability to be a real Christian. It comes with the word. It comes over time. You start to realize if you start studying it more. Sorry, that's my own words. Last Sunday's sermon mentioned 1 Peter 18-19. For you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from your ancestors. This may sound obvious to you, but secular liberalism doesn't seem empty in some way, despite all the things my educated middle-class tribe has to be grateful for. If that's what's been handed down to me, I want more, especially for my precious kids, and I'm trying. Bam.
Powerful letter.
That was just, it was amazing letter to see and read, and I got done with it. I just sat back and I thought to myself, my word. I mean, that's a complete change. To be a secular liberal and have a complete changeover to wanting to study and become a Christian conservative, you know, she was talking about faith and believing in the supernatural and everything. But, you know, that comes with your studying of the word, and it becomes less and less supernatural and coincidence as it does just truth.
I wonder if, you know, we were always talking about this election cycle, unlike others, having so much in the way of, effect, you know, having, you know, and, you know, there's a lot of discussion from both sides about the change of ideologies mm-hmm. between the parties over the last, you know, 100 years. And, you know, I wonder if maybe what we're seeing might be that,
Turning tides.
Turning tides, right. Yeah. The ideology between the parties flipping and doing another 180. There's I think in
that's
the context,
a natural thing.
Right. And I think in the context, it's used a lot of times. It's used out of context. But I think there's a lot of truth to the fact that there has been ideological changes, mm-hmm. Really flip flopping back and forth over the last 100 years. And so, I wonder if you know the ideology that is the tolerant, you know, loving left, is slowly making its way and turning itself into the tolerant, loving right, and mm-hmm. you know how the left perceives the right is now becoming the hateful, you know, awful spewing left. So you know, we'll have to see. You know, that takes time. But
well, yeah, and it's, you know, this is nothing that ends up being permanent either, because what you actually see over the course of decades is a cyclical thing, right? I mean, mm-hmm. you have the you know, this the great generation growing up that then went into the hippie generation because those people were rebelling against the ideas of their parents, and then you had the Reagan Revolution after the hippie mm-hmm. generation, then you had this long span with the Clintons of going back again to the liberal, and this is why the presidents always go back and forth, you know? So I think that, you know, statistically speaking, you can actually find research out there right now that's showing that today's younger generations, not the millennials, the next generation that's coming up, places more value in marriage. They're having lower teenage birth pregnancies and everything. And I think there's a value being placed in the correct things again, you know?
Yeah, well, I mean, case in point, just look at the liberals in the late 60s and 70s, where the basis for their platform, you know, aside from Love Not War, was anti-government.
Yeah.
Being involved in their lives, and fast forward to now, and, you know, government has now become their savior, and mm-hmm. they want government involved in everything.
Bigger the better.
They want government to have, you know, ultimate power. You know, they forgot the fact that, you know, sometimes the person that ends up with that power isn't someone they like. But,
yeah.
Yeah, I'm curious to see if what we're seeing is another 180 ideological change as a result of this election. That would be interesting to follow.
Yeah, absolutely. So let's go over quickly, and anybody that's tuning in right now, you're more than welcome to click on, if you're commenting, I'll actually see those comments later. If you haven't clicked on the video, what I want you to do is click on the video. Once it becomes full screen, then those comments actually start showing up below for us to read. We've gotten a few comments so far. I'm just going to quickly go over the topics, and if you want to type any questions or comments in the meantime, I'd be happy to address those, or Brant can address those. And then we'll sign off from this, and we'll see you next Friday. So topics covered tonight: the Jackie Evanko, 16-year-old singer who's going to be doing the national anthem, is catching a lot of flack from people for doing it at Donald Trump's inauguration. People are basically trying to shame her into not doing it. You have a Maine Gas distributor who is refusing to cater to Trump supporters up in Maine. And he turns out to not have a license for the past, since 2012. So he's in a little trouble for that. Multiple Ivanka Trump stories. Ivanka was asked to remove paintings from her property that were showing up in her social media posts because the artists themselves saw the pictures and were offended that they were hanging in her house. You also had the incident where the JetBlue passenger accosted Ivanka Trump and was yelling obscenities at her while he was holding his kid and while her kids were with her. And people now trying to get the husband of that guy fired from his job based purely on circumstantial being there with him. People, the liberal that refused to help a woman that was stranded in the snow because of her Trump bumper sticker. You have Tomi Lahren, rest in peace Tomi Lahren, trending on Twitter, and the just hateful, disgusting tweets in regards to that. Charlie Sheen wanting Donald Trump to be one of the celebrities that 2016 took. You have, we talked about the social media, how Democratic women are most likely to delete or unfriend someone. And we went over the numbers of that, Democratic men and women versus Republican men and women, and what the unfriending stats are between those. You have that Muslim story of the woman who was in New York City on the subway, and her hijab was apparently stolen, and three Trump supporters attacked her. Turns out that was fake, and her sister tried to make it even worse, basically, by saying that the police should have never been involved, even though her sister filed a police report. He had a student pro-life sign that was talking about adoption as opposed to abortion that had to be taken down because precious little snowflakes were hurt by feeling uncomfortable around it. You had what I thought was hilarious, which is a family's Christmas card where the guy and his son were holding a sign that said peace on earth, while the wife and the daughters had Christmas lights wrapped around their wrists and tape over their mouths. And I pointed out, if the situation was reversed and it was the father and son that were gagged and taped up and the women were holding the thumbs up and the peace on earth, it would be completely fine. Steve Martin was attacked by the feminists for saying that Carrie Fisher was beautiful, and they want her to be remembered as a feminist more than anything else. So this is ridiculous. We talked about the Navy nixing the plans to rename all the positions that had man in their title because there was enough of a backlash with a petition that was signed and everything. We briefly talked about this Drexel University down in Philadelphia who said that all he wanted for Christmas was a white genocide. You can actually go to my page, the Generation Y Conservative on Facebook, and read that whole article, see what his tweets were, his absolutely horrendous and horrible and lame attempts to follow that up with actual reasoning. Where in an example, he said, "Sorry, I'm not alt-left, just an actual communist."
Well, at least he's calling honest. It yeah.
Spade to spade. Yeah. And then we ended just now with the letter from a former liberal California citizen that is turning to Christian conservative values, and her letter that she wrote to the website The American Conservative, which absolutely just blew me away on her skill set, on how she wrote it, what she said in it, in a non-offensive way, I might add. She just threw the facts out there on how people act and everything. And I thought that was fantastic. So, anything that you want to add before we get going?
No, I think you covered it.
All right. So, once again, thank you guys for joining in to the Generation Y Conservative. If you're watching right now, like I said, you're watching on Facebook Live. If not, you are watching on YouTube, which you can find by searching the Generation Y Conservative on YouTube, where you'll find the whole set behind me, not just these blackboards. And that will give you the HD audio from our microphones here, as well as the HD video, which is filming over there. And I encourage you to do that. Subscribe to the Generation Y Conservative YouTube channel. Go and hit like on the Generation Y Conservative Facebook page. Go to Twitter at Gen Y Conservative without the E on the end, and follow me on Twitter as well and get involved in those interactions as well there. I want to thank you guys for tuning in. It was a blast. I want to thank Brant for coming and spending some time with me as a co-host. We're going to do this a lot more frequently with different co-hosts, as well as inviting him back when he has the time. This is kind of one of my 2017 plans. I think it'll be fun and open up the conversation more. And if you are one of those types of people that knows that they're in my area and are interested in coming on, even if you are a liberal, I'll decide on, you know, how much of a fight we want to get into and talk over each other. But you're more than welcome to make it known to me that you're interested in coming and joining me here, because we can certainly have even crazier discussions. And
that'd be a two-hour episode.
Two-hour episodes, yeah, where we just talk about one topic the whole time. So thanks again for tuning in. I appreciate it. And follow me on social media. Have a great night.